my original vision was to have a song that started with me and Simon, a la Quadrant 4, classic fusion song. Zach sounds great in it. Yeah. Billy Sheehan is just all guns a-blazing. Billy was the only choice for bass on this track. My very first rock concert was Van Halen in 1980, and the opening band was Talus. The bass player was Billy Sheehan.
I play with Derek in Sons of Apollo. I played with him in PSMS, and we've done a bunch of sessions together over the years. Derek is famous for laying some difficult stuff on me, some complicated lines, so I'm glad he had a little mercy on the system. I'm glad Zach Wild's on the track. I've jammed with Zach a bunch of times, and he's a great player.
Derek's thing is the back in the way it used to be, where you had a mini Moog. You had to create the sound, and so therefore it made it your sound. We don't really hear people that have influences from the people we grew up listening to. In Derek's playing, I hear the influences, but he's also made it his own, and he's always got that very distinctive sound, and I think that's what puts him apart from many other players.
I can't say enough about Simon Phillips, how amazing he is, how righteous his playing is.
I love the fact that Simon can rock but play anything else. There's not many musicians on any instrument that can do that convincingly.
Yeah.
It's a rarity, it really, really is. It's rock, but it's in 13. It has like a Return to Forever kind of melody on top of it. It's like lines intertwining, little melodies.
Again, you know, I mean, it's a perfect co-write. It's, you know, Derek came up with the initial thing and we sorted it out, and then I think I came up with a bit of melody, and then maybe we added another section. It just goes through the normal process. Each songwriting team has a process, and everybody's is very different. And what I love about the whole concept of composing, there's a lot of accidents. It's great. And nothing is in stone, because you're not recording it. You're not in a studio with, you know, the time going by. Trying to figure out, well, should we make that a D minor? Or should that be just a four suspend? You know, it's like, so in a way, there's no pressure. It's, so you just kind of go, well, let's try this. How does that work? Derek is really good at editing, self-editing. In fact, I've learned a lot from him doing that. He just knows exactly how to get rid of stuff you don't need. It's funny, and I go, are you sure you really want to take that? That was actually really cool. Yeah. And it's interesting. I would say, I mean, 9 times out of 10, you're absolutely right. It's really great, it's lovely.
Here we are, I'm playing on Derek's album again. I've done 8 of them. All of his solo albums have appeared on. It's been an amazing journey. And this is a beautiful track that I played on called Clouds of Ganymede with Steve Vai on guitar.
It was very awesome that he guested on this. He was like the very first person I thought of for the melodies. It's very Holdsworthy in the song. It reminds me of UK, and Vai has that legato slurring style, which I thought would be perfect for the record.
Whenever I hear Tony's fretless bass on my music, it feels like home. He has a very warm and distinct signature sound.
Dragonfly, that was written all on piano. So I just started writing, letting my hands go. And once I start honing in on it, I'll just start fine-tuning it. And then you find the next section that's related to, okay, where do I go from here? And so I brought the foundation to Simon, and Simon immediately goes, wow, this is really good. He goes, let me take it from here. He just went and wrote that whole, like from where the bass comes in, all of those sections, Simon just took charge, and it's fantastic. I don't think Simon realizes what I went through to actually be able to play that up to speed and clean.
I was stunned. When Derek came up here to the studio and he started playing it, I went, he's got it. Wow, I know how much you must have put into that. And of course, then the conscious decision to keep it absolutely acoustic, We at one point there was a little synth pad in there, and we just decided, no, let's lose it. Nice. Let's make this song pure trio, you know. And what was cool, I did a lot of work with Hiromi, the Hiromi trio with Anthony Jackson, and it sonically reminded me very much of some of the stuff we used to do.
This song was very inspired by Return to Forever.
Well, the nickname was RTF.
RTF.
Yeah, that was our working title. This new album is much more analog, much thicker. It's not all in the box. I mix half in the box, half out of the box. I'm stemming out, and it's going through analog transformers. It does give a certain sheen and thickness to the tone.
I think for me, sonically, I've gone a lot more to the B3 as time went on. Like, I didn't use the B3 as much as I do now. And also more analog tones, like I'm using the Moog a lot more than in the past. Them Changes is special to me because I used to play with Buddy Miles. That was my very first gig, and Buddy used to call me Mortimer for some reason. I don't know where this nickname came from, but he'd always say, Mortimer, you gotta listen to the train. There's a train in every song, the groove. Yeah. And that was a gift. You know, I really am, you know, grateful for that experience. I feel I'm going out of my mind.
Great, yeah. Now, Buddy, well, funnily enough, my favorite rendition of Jimi Hendrix was the Band of Gypsies. That's when I really went, because that's what I was into, you know? I mean, I love Mitch. I kind of got into that afterwards, but it was when I heard Buddy and Billy Cox, I went, oh, yes. It made Jimmy play differently.
Joe Bonamassa, great performance in here. He came in and nailed it. Sounds like Hendrix. Yeah.
I think we actually both had a little connection there with Buddy and this song. And also from a mixing point of view, I made it very 70s. You know, I listened to the original version, so it's very dry, much drier than everything else.
Me playing with Buddy Miles, that's like 1 degree from Jimi Hendrix. And playing with Simon, that's 1 degree from Jeff Beck. Being that close to the source, it's awesome.
I like to think that Buddy Miles is up there in heaven smiling, looking down, saying, Mortimer, me and Jimmy are proud of you.
Octopus Pedigree. I was one of the first batch of four that I brought to Simon, and we just developed it. Bumblefoot sounds great.
He sounds amazing.
He's a great player.
He's a really great player.
He's very unique, playing fretless guitar. I don't hear that very often, and his chops are amazing.
There are certain songs that make you feel like there's fireworks going off in your brain when you hear them. Octopus Pedigree is definitely one of those songs. Wherever you look or listen, there's something going on. It's like a big circus. The drums are incredible. The bass is just locking in and kicking ass.
Jimmy Johnson, one of my favorite fusion bass players, has played on many of our records that we've done together, and you can't find a finer player. The alembic is so fat, that his bass, you listen to this guy's bass even not plugged in, and you could just tell that this instrument is just a gorgeous sounding.
He's had it years too. Beautiful sound though. I mean, I just, because you know, Jimmy's his tone and his tonality, the way he hears things. I put that fader up and, well, there's a bass.
Another great drum solo in Octopus Pedigree. A lot of drum solos.
Yeah.
Pesadelo is a song I wrote with Kiko, who's a great guitar player. I've known Kiko many years. and it was the first time we ever got to write together. I saw a clip of him where he was playing nylon guitar, and I thought it was really cool, and I said, hey, that'd be cool if we could incorporate a section where you can cut on the nylon, and so he kind of took it from there. Simon did some percussion underneath it.
So I know Derek Sherinian for a long time. I'm a big fan of his work, and we're neighbors in Los Angeles, but we never really played together or collaborated together. So this song, Pesadelo, was the first time we did something together. So I remember when he sent me this riff played in the Rhodes, and then he invited me to go to his studio, and then we start jamming and discussing how we could build a song from that riff. And then we brainstorm a lot of ideas, and I remember, you know, getting my acoustic guitar as well. We wanted to have, you know, a breakdown with nylon strings, the 7-string guitar, and I remember playing keyboards in front of Derek Sherinian, which was quite challenging for me. So I suggested the melody for the song. So it was a very nice afternoon that we brainstormed the idea for the song Pesadelo. Then later I recorded the actual rhythm tracks for Simon Phillips to put all his magic, his finesse, you know, then the song just flourished with his drums and percussion. And then after Tony Franklin, so I mean, it's a beautiful composition.
Pesadelo was a challenging piece for me. As always, Derek's music pushes me to my limits, and I love it, I really do. And I want to give a nod to Derek's skills for putting together the right players with the right piece of music. You put the wrong players on a piece of music and it will just not bring out the best in it. So it is a real gift to be able to do that.
That was very different. It was actually very unorthodox, the groove. And in fact, it was here when we were recording that I really didn't know quite what to play in that first section. And I tried a couple of things and I went, let's look at this differently. Let's think outside the box. And that's where I came up with that whole tom-tom thing.
Yeah.
To really make it different from all the other tracks. I was thinking, I wonder if Derek's going to dig this, you know? It was very different. I think you were like, oh, that's actually cool. That's going to sound good. And then we
really
worked on it, and that's what it became, you know?
It's an amazing feeling for me to be part of the new album from Derek Sherinian. So please enjoy the song, Pesadelo.